And I hate the titles, man. The titles of every Hallmark movie are just, it's always like, A Sprinkle of Love, now on Hallmark, or some kind of shit, like Deck My Halls. It's like the worst. Snow Globe for, I'm not kidding you. Go look up Hallmark movies, and a lot of them are just a title with For Christmas at the end. It's
A
Lawyer for Christmas.
Out of Town Lawyer for Christmas.
A Husband for Christmas.
Oh my God.
A Cookie for Christmas. It's insane.
I'm so ready.
We're going to read off this list, and it's not made up, I promise.
Lights, camera, action.
UPS, you piece of shit.
I was like, you know what I want to do one day? I want to join a gang.
We're in 2022. Upgrade the cameras. You can see Saturn and shit, but like, I can't get a clear picture of someone robbing the gas station.
That was the greatest night in the history of television.
Ah, yes. The music tropes.
Mm-hmm.
What? So, that's a fun one to dive into. What comes to mind for you on that?
First of all, I'm going to hit you with the one that just I can't stand.
Yeah.
It's out the top of my head, and that is A. You know what I'm talking about?
That, oh, A.
Like someone says a line and then immediately follows it with A.
I like
that. Why are we doing that? It's, I'm going to go to the store, A. I'm going to buy this bread for this whore, A.
Yeah.
Here we go, saying something else, and then A.
Yeah.
Stop that.
Right.
Cut that shit out. Right. You're just delaying because you can't think of your next line.
That's it, and that's exactly right.
I hate that.
I wonder, because I'll write a little rap, hip hop here and there.
Yeah.
And I like to wonder, because I will, in fact, I have written in ad libs before. So I wonder if when they're writing that on their notes app.
Do they just put A?
Exactly. I think so. I actually think so.
Yeah.
I think that's part of it.
Well, I want to know what I want to talk to a rapper and like, what is the thought process behind that?
Yeah.
Is that just like a universal, oh, we all decided this was an art form.
Right.
To say A after everything.
I've been spinning on the ops. A. Mm. I've been fucking around a cop.
A.
I don't fuck with no one being. A. I don't care. About A. Right?
Yeah, yeah. Why? Does that bother anybody else? Because I can't stand it.
Well, the ad libs, I mean, the ad libs have become a. A.
A.
They've kind of become a trope in and of themselves, and they've become kind of like a signature for particular artists.
Mm-hmm.
I think of This Is America, Childish Gambino.
Yeah.
And in that song, he had a bunch of different rappers come in and do their little ad libs, whatever their particular signature ad lib is.
Yeah.
So you got your A and you got your yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm just gonna get saying yeah. I was gonna get yeah, yeah, you know. and I don't even know. There's like other ones. Migos. I don't know what else. I actually just don't. I can't think off the top of my head.
Yeah.
But A has got to go.
Please.
That's what I'm hearing from you.
In my opinion, like there's got to be something more creative.
Mm-hmm.
I understand every artist having their signature. For sure. Like you've got Jay-Z who's like,
that's a good one.
That's a, yeah. We it's like a that. Vocal record scratch.
Is there, does Kanye have one of these?
His is pretty annoying. It's, huh? He just can't hear. That's his signature.
That is, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's exactly what it is. Oh, that's wonderful. Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
Isn't that exciting? So the musical trope that I hate, I don't think it exists anymore. I think one of the worst musical tropes that we had was from, it was like in our high school, the end of our high school era, early college era.
Okay.
And it was like those pop bluegrass folk bands. That always had like a bridge where it was kind of like, whoa, 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 whoa. And it was like, and it was kind of like very like bluegrassy country, but like clearly pop.
Why?
It was like one of those like, hey.
Yeah. Yeah. What is that song? It's, I know. I literally know the song
Yeah.
that sounds like that.
Like what are the some, like, is the Black Keys part of that? Maybe.
Or like of Mice and Men.
Of Mice
or Monsters and Men.
Now, Of Monsters and Men is one of my guilty pleasures.
I do like a lot of their
fucks with that
songs. Yeah.
If there's a good version of that, that's them to me. For me, that's, they're the only ones who can actually do that.
I think their song is the one that I'm thinking of where they do that. Hey. And then,
hey.
And like the, I think Philip Phillips.
Sure.
Remember that?
Wasn't, he sounds like that.
Wasn't his song Home? Wasn't that like our class song?
Dude.
Why did we pick that as our class? Was that our
class? Ugh. It's 2013. It's really, really freshly around that area. It's,
yeah.
Yeah.
I think the song Dirty Paws.
I see
of Monsters and Men.
Down in my window.
I think this is a, I think it has
this to. Is exactly on brand of what I'm talking about.
Fast forward. They're going to do it in a second. Here it comes. It's like literally what you just said.
But I feel like, and so that's like the, that's like the white people version of A.
Yeah. They just added a letter.
Yeah.
Hey.
that's the white people version of A from that like same era.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
I got one. They're all flooding in now.
Yeah.
I can't stand the type of singing where it sounds like the person has something in their throat.
Mm.
I don't know where we picked this up, this style of vocal usage.
Yeah.
But I hate it. I hate it. And I feel like more and more artists are using it where they got that like,
oh,
almost like a little Lilo and Kermit mix.
Oh,
I'm a singer, song that the better that.
It's, oh,
it's a little bit of Adam Levine from Maroon 5.
Yeah.
But worse.
I think one of my favorite songs of that type of vocal, I'll play it for you.
Yes, please do.
And this song is a Trobias song, and yet I have it.
Oh, good.
On my playlist.
Yeah, but we've got guilty pleasures
now. Yeah, that's the thing. We're only gonna roast things from sometimes from a place of love, sometimes it's from a place of hate.
True.
But every once in a while, now this kind of goes,
this sounds familiar.
Yeah.
What is this?
I think you'll know this one. I feel like he kind of does that voice.
Yeah.
You know?
It's there.
I don't know. I know. Damn. That was a lot.
Yeah.
That. No.
Oh, I know this song.
Now, this shit kind of goes,
yeah,
though.
Like, not gonna lie. It hits I'm a little like, bit.
This man right here.
Who is that?
Lights Down Low by Max.
Max.
Now here's the problem with a guy like Max. That's the only good song he has. He has not and will never make another good song.
Is it Max with a like two X's?
Actually, no. I wish it was.
Is it all caps?
It is all caps.
I feel like I have a song by that person.
Okay.
But it's not that one.
Yeah.
Yeah, the biggest meme going around right now is from that Tom's Diner song. You know what I'm talking about?
I don't know that one. I'm going to need to hear it.
So Tom's Diner has been like sampled a ton. It's. So on TikTok, there's a, I don't know, they're like a coffee shop looking band and they might be in a coffee shop.
Sure.
And they have that singing style where they're like. Like, that's how they sound, because I don't know the words, so I'm just, like, making up gibberish.
You are brilliant at that.
But, yeah, and then a guy made fun of it, because why wouldn't you? They sound
why wouldn't you?
Fucking absurd. Oh, here we go.
The fuck?
I hate that. I hate that.
That guy sucks at singing.
Yeah.
Did he create an accent at the end for the man to pour the coffee? He did.
I think he just, yeah, he like made it up.
He said like for ta man to pour ta coffee.
For ta man to pour the coffee.
Like a like, German.
Like, don't ever do that again. And then this guy made my favorite rendition of it. This is how I feel it, it really is. Yeah.
You gotta love the good, the cutoff, man.
Yeah.
The cutoff gag is amazing on TikTok.
That is a trope that can stay. I like that.
We like that. Yeah. Well, you got to have that. We need people that we need because that the first guy takes himself so seriously and he thinks he's really doing something.
Yes.
He really thinks he's him. Mm-hmm. He thinks he's the guy. He thinks he's the main character. And we got to have people like that other person who's the actual genius, who's the actual main character, who's actually him. To come in and point out how fucking absurd that is. The first guy singing, the first guy, the one who thinks takes himself way too seriously, that is the social media version of guy pulling out his guitar on the college campus and playing Wonderwall.
Yeah.
Which is another trope.
Another, yeah. Are we using that word right too? Trope? I think so.
I hope so. Let's trope, look at cliche. Let's look at the Websters of trope.
Let's see. Because if it's not trope, it's cliche. And if it's not cliche, it's just something that is far overused. I've also noticed that since Billie Eilish came into the industry, a lot more people are starting to sing like her.
Right.
Which, okay, but let's not overdo. It's to the point where I'm having a harder time distinguishing between artists where I'll think one person's song is someone else and it's not. And I think that's a problem. Like, you should have your own sound.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So a trope is the Google definition, which I don't know if that comes from Webster's. A figurative or metaphorical use of a word or expression. So maybe not.
I don't think. Okay, maybe we're not using that word right. Not a trope.
So cliche is fine.
Cliche.
I like trope. I like to.
It sounds more sophisticated.
It does. It makes me feel better about myself.
Yeah, for sure.
So, no, yeah. I think, and I can't really think in my head of like what Billie Eilish sings like, because all I can hear her in my head is kind of the whisper singing, I'm a bad guy. Yeah. You know?
Yeah.
That's all I hear.
Perfect. Spot on.
Are people doing that too?
Or like, is it they're kind of doing singing? That like lower whispery. Well, yeah. Olivia Rodrigo kind of channeled that in some of her songs.
Right.
Specifically the... I guess she kind of does that vocal thing too. Got my driving license last night.
Yeah.
I don't know why it gets under my skin. It works sometimes for some people. It hits. Other times I'm like, get out of here.
I like the music. The music and the movie tropes go together sometimes. I was watching whenever Spider-Man, the new lovely one, No Way Home.
Yes.
Right? Or Far From Home. No Way Home. When No Way Home came out, and we revisited Amazing Spider-Man 2.
Yeah.
It had the hey type of songs in there.
Okay.
And it had a scene of just, you know, he's working on science stuff and it's just dubstep. It's just Skrillex.
Really?
And I'm like, yeah, this was a bad time. This was a bad time to throw Skrillex in there. We didn't need Skrillex.
I don't remember that.
It was a little painful. It was hard. So there was both of those. Amazing Spider-Man 2's music choices encapsulate our late high school era.
Yeah.
I was too busy. So I was too busy at that time, at least listening to like early Tyler, the Creator, where he was doing like devil worship music, you know? Like,
yeah.
And I was also listening to obscure, like hardcore death metal music. And so I didn't have my finger on the pulse at that time for that music. But you look back and you can just feel it's awkward.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't listen to a whole lot of Tyler, the Creator, I don't think. I did. I always liked whenever he just went hardcore, like, I don't know what the song's called, but he's like, I'm a fucking walking paradox. You're like, whoa.
Yeah. Hey, hey now. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we should call that era like Tyler's in the closet still, you know, because it's very angry. It's very like it's suppressed. He's still in the closet.
Yeah.
I think even he'd admit that that's what that is. I think even he'd agree.
He's probably like, sorry, everyone, about that.
Well, so that was, I mean, that's another trope that's interesting to me. And that goes even into the Billie Eilish, which is the like super Satan-y, demon-y shit.
Yeah.
Early Billie Eilish, I mean, that's her whole aesthetic was like Satan, demon, mentally ill.
Yeah.
And I relate, you know, but it's weird. Into the relatively conspiracy realm, it seems like artists have to go there to break into the industry and then they get to do whatever they want. Tyler, the Creator, also started off super satanic, super upside down crosses, demonic shit. And then now he gets to be like a jazzy, poppy rapper.
And like make waffles on YouTube. Yeah.
So that's an interesting trope. Demony. I mean, and that's even you think about like horror film tropes. I mean, like Paranormal Activity like changed the game.
Oh yeah, the found footage. That's true. We went through a phase where found footage was everything. Cloverfield.
Yes.
All the Paranormal Activities. I feel like there was another one. There was that one, The Gallows.
Yeah.
I don't know if you saw that.
Yeah, I think.
It like takes place in a high school and they're like, it's about like a play. They're trying to put on a play, but like someone died backstage a long time ago or hung themselves. And so they haunt the theater. And
that's fun.
But it's all found footage.
Yeah. And then Project X.
Project X, huge.
Yeah.
That one was great. Still is. Holds up.
It reminds me of our high school. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, I guess maybe that's why I think it holds up.
I like it. It's just like it was perfect. You know,
the music in that movie is. That whole album.
Kid Cudi. It's like, that's a good trope.
Mm-hmm.
Good trope.
Actually, the Tyler, the Creator bit thing that I just said is in that album.
Oh, yeah.
Trouble on my mind. Yeah.
I like that.
And he says that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, those musical cliches, those overuses of things. I'm sure there's like a ton more.
There's a lot.
Like as we talked about last week, the sampling of songs that really aren't even that old.
Yeah.
And not doing anything super special with them. Just kind of like.
Yeah. Now I'm remembering. We trashed DJ Khaled, didn't we, last week?
DJ Khaled's a...
We took a big old shit on him, didn't we?
And not as big of a one as we will when we do a whole episode dedicated to him.
We'll do a whole DJ Khaled fucking shit on sesh.
Something's going on there. That's for sure.
Cleveland Steamer on him.
Yeah.
Right. Fucking.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely. So what are some, okay, so like, let's get into the nitty gritty of like cliches that I can think of. Obviously, I think the first one that comes to my mind is miscommunication between two main characters that could be easily resolved by the main character speaking up in that moment.
Oh.
But the main character stays quiet.
Yes.
And the other main character remains upset and walks away. And then main character says, wait.
Yes.
And you as the viewer are sitting there saying, just say it, you fuck. You stupid fuck. It's just going to prolong. And so, I don't know, what are we, like, let's say, like, there's one that comes to mind, like, as of recently. It was about the girl who gets revenge on men for being creepy. I don't know. It was a good one. But anyways, she gets seen with, like, she starts to like this guy.
Mm-hmm.
But her whole thing is that she tricks guys into thinking she's drunk and take her home and, like, are about to like be inappropriate.
Oh.
More than inappropriate. Gonna be like fucking super illegal towards her. And then she's like, I'm not drunk now, motherfucker. Like, and she scares him straight, basically. She doesn't kill him. I wish she would kill him.
Yeah.
But anyways, the guy she starts to like sees her out on one of these things. So sees her pretending to be drunk with this random guy and is like, oh, you're just like some hussy who's out here hussying.
Yeah.
And then she's like, wait. And he's like, no, it's fine. I can see what's going on here.
Oh, I'm so glad you said that, because even since a kid, that always bothered me. I wanted to scream at the TV and say, how hard is it to just say the thing?
Right.
Yeah, I don't know why they do that. I guess it's because I don't even have an explanation for it. Like, from a writing standpoint, I guess you want to prolong the drama and develop the story and have the characters be introspective or whatever.
Something.
I mean, you would resolve something too quickly as a writer, right? Sure. If you had them just say the thing.
I guess it creates more conflict, but it can't resolve it.
Yeah.
It has to create more. It has to dig the main character into a deeper hole of conflict. It has to dig the person who is angry into a deeper hole of conflict. I guess it creates conflict too if things are too good. Like in that one, it's like they're, you know, starting to really like each other. Everything's going perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
And even in that movie, it's like, I get that one, because that girl can't just be like, I trick guys into thinking I'm drunk. I trick predators into taking me home and trying to sexually assault me so that I can scare them straight and make them realize that they're fucking creepy predators. So I'm sure I get that. She's not just going to blurt that out.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. It's kind of a lot to unload in the middle of the street where I'm assuming the scene took place.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So
it was probably raining.
Probably raining. That's a good, always. It's always raining.
It's always raining at the right time, at the perfect time.
So, but yeah, but there's a lot of movies where it's not, where it's just like,
standing in their living room.
Yeah.
I guess the idea is, from an artistic standpoint, it's like, let's explore all the things in what's not said.
Right.
There's a lot to explore in silences. True.
True.
But sometimes you're like, this could be resolved if you just said the thing right now. Like, just say it.
5 seconds.
Just say the thing.
Mm-hmm. 5 seconds.
Yeah. It is highly frustrating. Which maybe that could be the approach to evoke frustration from the audience.
Yeah.
If so, good job.
It works.
Yeah, it works.
It works. Because it makes me very mad. I think that, and that's pretty common in romantic comedies.
Yeah.
For sure. It's that exact thing. It's a device, used to let the ball drop. You know, it's like things are going too good.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we need to stir it up.
Yeah.
And it's true. I mean, it wouldn't be a movie unless it was that.
Yeah.
You know, because then if not, it would be half an hour of two people meeting to each other and then things go real great. And then boom, that's it.
Yeah. Romantic comedies. And I want to say, well, you know, every genre actually has their things. Romantic comedies for sure. Like the beats.
Right.
And the beats of that and the buddy cop are actually pretty similar if you think about it.
Huh.
They've got where they meet.
Yeah.
They've got, you know, like their differences at first. They probably don't really get along, don't really like each other.
Right.
And then something happens and they click.
Right.
They're the best of friends, or they're the best relationship. They're highly in love. They're on a montage of doing stuff.
Mm.
And then there's a breaking point that splits them apart, whether that's a secret that they've been keeping, a lie that they told or whatever, or like a... something from their past that they didn't divulge.
Mm-hmm.
And that always ends up coming out at the 3/4 part. Sends the person, I can't believe you, walking away, you know, or the buddy cop, like, maybe we're just better off on our own.
Right.
Walking away. And then something happens to bring them together at the end.
Mm-hmm.
It's a literal formula.
It like is.
And those two movies, or those two genres of movies, are pretty similar in their beats.
I really love that, pointing that out, because that's perfect. Mm-hmm. And that's one of those that really just strips the illusion.
Yeah.
And now you can't unsee that.
No. 21 Jump Street. Go watch that and tell me I'm not wrong with my beats.
Right.
The Other Guys.
Yep.
Go yeah. watch that.
Oh, that's a great one.
Yeah. And it is a good one.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that the beat sheet makes it a bad movie.
No.
They can still do it really well.
It's great for the example, though.
Yeah.
100%. And I think it all comes down to, I don't know why this comes up to mind, but it all comes down to, and I don't know if The Odd Couple took their beats from something else, but The Odd Couple, the concept of The Odd Couple, the movie, The Odd Couple, the play.
Yeah.
The Odd Couple. You look at that and it's like that. That's like it.
Fits it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then pretty much every romantic comedy, pretty much every Hallmark movie.
That's a lot. So is that one of those where it's like the cliche, the trope is domestic violence? No, I'm just kidding.
I wish. No. Right.
That'd be a little more like intriguing.
Yeah. Yeah, no, man. I mean, the Hallmark movie, I could tell you every Hallmark movie without seeing one.
Okay. Do it.
It's some small town.
Yes.
And it's some girl opening up her snow globe shop or some shit like that. Flower shop, candy store.
Right.
Whatever the fuck it is.
Right.
And then some big, handsome, tall businessman comes to town. Mm-hmm. He's from the city and he's scouting his next location to set up his business.
Mm.
And they don't get along with each other. Right. She's not liking the big business. He kind of, you know, sees over the small shop girl, but at the same time, she's enchanting, right? She's charming. Sure. Yeah. Charismatic. There's something about her.
She's different.
Yeah. There's usually some kind of thing that pits them together for whatever reason. Or it's a small town, so they keep bumping into each other at the farmer's market or the pumpkin patch, whatever the fuck it is. And then, you know, you sprinkle a little bit of Christmas magic in there, right? Yes. Like maybe her dad is dying or something like that.
Any of the holidays, right?
Yeah.
Like it could work for around any of the holidays.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For sure. For sure. And then you just go right into the beat sheet that I said where they do get together and then it's love and it's magical. It's like nothing they've ever seen. And then they have that splitting moment, whether it's, oh, you're still going to go through with putting up your business? When I'm a small business, how could you? And they go their separate ways. And then
I'm thinking it's she finds out he's married.
That, yeah.
But he's about to get a divorce.
Mm-hmm.
Like they're split up.
That's probably one. That's
you
probably
know,
one.
And it's like, you're married. And he could just say like, no, I'm on paper. I'm fucking married.
Yeah.
But we're literally don't even live in the same house. I'm working on divorce papers right now.
Yeah.
Except he doesn't.
He doesn't.
No.
Yeah. Here's another one for you. She's a small town chef.
Okay.
And he's a food critic.
Yeah. Oh.
And so naturally they're not going to like each other.
Right.
Little Ratatouille situation. I don't know. And I hate the titles, man. The titles of every Hallmark movie are just, it's always like A Sprinkle of Love. Now on Hallmark or some kind of shit like Deck My Halls. It's like the worst snow globe for, I'm not kidding you. Go look up Hallmark movies and a lot of them are just a title with For Christmas at the end. It's
A
lawyer for Christmas.
Out of town lawyer for Christmas.
A husband for Christmas.
Oh my God.
A cookie for Christmas. It's insane.
I'm so ready.
We're going to read off this list and it's not made up. I promise.
Okay. So first of all, Hallmark movies now, a streaming service.
Stop. Don't do that.
Okay, so I got a couple here that seem perfect for this little reading off of So It Was Always You.
Nice. Original.
A Hallmark original.
A Hallmark original, yeah.
Just like HBO Max has originals, Netflix has originals, Hulu has originals, so does Hallmark.
Awesome.
It Was Always You.
Mm-hmm.
Sailing Into Love.
Oh.
Obviously taking place on a cruise.
So can you pull up the description for Sailing Into Love?
Yes, absolutely.
I would love to see if it fits what I've just said at all.
It's like the first. Okay. Biology teacher Claire. Why does that kill me? Biology teacher Claire is a bridesmaid, never the bride.
Oh, wow. Yep. Oh, we've never seen that before in a Hallmark movie.
Okay, this takes a left turn. Biology teacher Claire is a bridesmaid and conducts a class on Blue Island.
Huh.
What is Blue Island? Okay. Claire takes action when she learns her former boyfriend works for the developer building a resort on Blue Island. Perfect.
So Blue Island is just another way of saying small town.
Yes.
And what does he do again?
Well, he's a developer building a resort on Blue Island. You called that shit.
I wish there was a camera in here so I could look at it and do this.
And do the Jim Halpert face. Yeah.
I literally just fucking said that.
You called that shit. So it's always like that. And it's always, yeah, it's always a very white, very business savvy type of fella.
Yes. You absolutely.
We've got a Hallmark original Winter Castle.
Hmm.
Okay.
Let me guess. That one is she goes maybe to London for Christmas. And falls in love with, like, this guy and doesn't realize until later that he's a prince.
So it feels like they actually, they phoned it in on this one. This doesn't, when Jenny attends a wedding at a, it's always a fucking wedding. With
so
shit.
Many weddings.
Why?
And she attending it. She's never
she's
getting.
She's attending it.
Yeah.
At a magical ice hotel. She is surprised when she connects with the best man, Craig, and his daughter. Okay, so he, and then he's like a single dad.
Oh.
Right?
Yeah.
So he's like a single, yeah. So he's like a single dad. And she's like, I will complete you.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be the Holy Trinity.
Yeah.
I love this. This is a fun game.
This is a great game.
I'm going to throw two back to back here without taking a breath in between them.
Okay.
Chesapeake Shores Autumn Stables.
Wow. Chesapeake Shores Autumn Stables.
Those are two separate movies, but titles are.
Yeah.
I'm interested in seeing what Autumn Stables is about.
So Autumn Stables, I can tell you, is a girl from a small town who lives countryside. And she's very good with horses. She's a horse breeder. She has horses, whatever. She brings them up. And a big businessman comes to town,
right.
Something, something, something. They can't stand each other. Maybe he wants to turn the horse into a racehorse. She doesn't like that. I don't know. Like Hallmark, what is it actually?
So they're going a little bit lower class with this.
Okay.
So they're not doing the money, the big money thing on this one. But they're using an interesting trope here that I imagine they use a lot. After the death of her husband.
Ah, that's a, yeah, that is a.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Autumn Carlyle sells her ranch. Well, okay, so this guy must have some money. She's selling a ranch to him.
Yeah.
But to handsome carpenter Jake Stevens.
Handsome carpenter. So not businessman.
Yeah.
But good with his hands.
You know, okay, I'm seeing a diverse interracial one here because it's been very white.
Yeah.
The vows we keep.
Hmm.
The vows we keep. This guy looks like, I mean, he looks like a former NBA player from the 90s who's now a sports commentator. I'm going to go ahead and hand you that there.
Let me take a look at this.
That interracial.
Huh.
Time.
An event planner must organize the perfect wedding. Again, with the fucking weddings, yeah. Man. Chill out, Hallmark. For her sister in less than a month when she finds out the Rosewood, a historic inn and adored wedding venue, is being sold. I'm assuming to this guy.
Yeah.
Probably.
To like the black guy who, but he's like, he's in business.
Yeah.
And he's not too black.
He kind of, he's given me David Blaine.
Yeah.
And like French Montana.
Yeah. Oh, French Montana. That's exactly what this guy looks like.
Yeah.
I love that.
So I want to just validate what I said earlier about the whole for Christmas thing.
Yes.
I'll just read off a couple. Because those weren't Hallmark Christmas movies,
none
right?
Of
those
them were just for Christmas.
Hallmark, but these are. Okay. A Bride for Christmas.
That's a Bride?
Real. A Bride for Christmas.
It's all okay. I'm going to a wedding today, actually. It's kind of funny.
that's great. That's right on theme with what perfect. We're working with. Is that Carrie Fisher? It is Carrie Fisher. It's called It's Christmas Carol. I'm assuming her name's Carol. And maybe she struggles with a cocaine addiction.
Well, okay. You know, if you're in Hollywood and you're Carrie Fisher and you're doing that movie.
Yeah.
It's for drug money.
And
God rest her soul.
Yes, absolutely. Snow is a different kind of snow in that movie. We have North Pole open for Christmas. That's the whole title.
North Pole. They could have just called it North Pole. I don't need to know about. I would have guessed.
Yeah. Here's a princess for Christmas. A grandpa for Christmas.
Come on.
You think I'm making these up? Right there on the left.
Where's a grandpa for Christmas?
Left side, about the middle.
A grandpa for Christmas?
Yeah. And the O in four is like a ball that you would hang on a Christmas tree.
Oh, my God.
And the list just goes on and on.
A grandpa for Christmas?
Yeah.
Okay, so that one's about... he's the patriarch of the family.
Mm-hmm.
He's grandpa.
Yeah.
Obviously. Right? His daughter... just got a divorce.
Mm-hmm.
And the little boy is distraught. He doesn't know what's what for. He's a child. He's going through a very traumatic experience. Grandpa, he was a little, you know, disconnected from the family because him and daughter, you know, he's old school.
Yeah.
Right. So he says the N word sometimes and it's fine, yeah, you know,
in a Hallmark movie. He's
it's a different time.
Yeah.
But then the boy shows him Minecraft.
Yeah.
And he's like, okay, it's a new era.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is a new world. Like, he shows him a Twitch streamer who plays Minecraft.
Yeah.
And he goes, okay, I got to step up and be good grandpa now.
I like that.
Yeah. But grandpa's, he has Alzheimer's.
Mm.
So every once in a while, he thinks the little boy is the Japanese.
Yeah.
And he just beats the shit out of him.
He locks him in the dog's kennel.
And it's Christmas. So.
And it's Christmas. It's snowing. I'm going to read. I have to read this now.
Yeah. Let's see how close I was.
You know, it's got a surprisingly high rating, a 6.9 out of 10.
That's not bad.
Like, that's really not bad.
I'm pretty sure Doctor Strange has the same. No, I'm just kidding.
It's like, yeah, it's 2 points removed from Everything Everywhere All at Once.
That's really?
Which has like an 8.2, I think,
that's,
out of 10.
See, come on.
So, we're wow, close. Okay. When an aging entertainer attempts to rebuild a bond with his estranged family,
yeah,
the retired movie star is unexpectedly called upon to care for his granddaughter.
Granddaughter.
He soon connects with the girl when she expresses a desire to appear in the school show.
Right, when she expresses a desire to be a YouTuber.
Yes.
And he's like, this is the new entertainment age.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, okay, well, we're going to mix old Hollywood with new YouTubing.
Yes.
And she becomes a star. And he ruins her life.
It's a worse version of A Star Is Born.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Hallmark. And now I wanted to do Lifetime.
Yeah. I'm just so curious what the Hallmark corporate offices are like. Like, they probably have, how most businesses have a mission statement.
Yeah.
Their mission statement is follow these rules. If your script doesn't have all these, you can't be a Hallmark writer.
Yeah.
And they just kind of like have a very basic idea and they just plug it into like probably even a, like a name generator that you would find online.
Yes.
It's like a script generator and then they just shoot it and they're like, yeah, that's fine.
Yeah. There was like a Jake Stevens, right? It's like, come on.
Yeah.
You know, that's like elementary.
Yeah.
Jake Stevens, Autumn Carlisle.
Right. Like, oh man. Yeah. The names are just so. Autumn Stables.
So what it is, to me, it would seem to truly be, jokes aside, like romance novels in film form.
Actually, yeah.
Not even like directly derived from, like, not like Harry Potter, but like, you know, not like how Harry Potter made Harry Potter movies, but like fucking, yeah, like just the romance novel, fucking the churning them out.
Yeah.
Fucking just, you know,
like, they're like this thick.
Exactly.
And it's got some like six-pack ad cowboy on the front of it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's completely it. I would like to see these movies get more diverse, and I would, and I understand, because that's not the, you know, because who is the people watching these?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, it is like a middle-aged alcoholic, like upper middle class woman who owns an AK-47 and is on QAnon forums. Like,
yeah.
That's who that is for. So they don't want too much color in there.
For sure.
But I'd like to see them go full, like, Hollywood, like, woke. And I'd like to see, like, interracial, non-binary Hallmark movies.
They, them for Christmas.
They, That's perfect. That's it.
And it's Ezra Miller throwing a chair at a girl in Hawaii.
Yeah. Oh, gosh. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ezra Miller for Christmas would be a horror film.
That's like Krampus. Krampus comes to town.
Ezra Miller needs to become an urban legend.
Yeah.
Like skinwalkers, like Krampus. Mm-hmm. And then there's Ezra Miller.
Yeah.
There's Chupacabra. There's La Llorona. And then there's Ezra Miller.
Yeah.
Don't go to Hawaii on the blood moon.
Mm.
Ezra Miller will come out.
That's when the strength is just increased.
Yeah.
Tenfold.
That's when the Flash.
Yeah.
Will come to play. Digging into this Lifetime here.
Yeah.
So these are, it's like the same as Hallmark,
mm-hmm.
but like death.
Ah.
And scary.
They're a little, that's true. Lifetime's a little bit more murderous housewife.
Yes. Yeah. So some of these titles are fun. A Baby at Any Cost.
That one, that's interesting.
That's a good start.
That's a good start.
That's a good start.
That could be a number of things.
Right. A Baby at Any Cost. Well, I do want to, let's see. I can already derive it kind of just based on the picture, I think. But when, okay, here, yeah. I bet you there's a, actually, okay, so I'm going to realize very quickly that I think nannies
mm-hmm.
are a huge part of the Lifetime formula.
I think so.
Nannies.
Yeah, nannies. Okay.
When a couple hires their surrogate to nanny, their bond grows tight, making the sister-in-law increasingly jealous. Okay, sister-in-laws are probably a big deal too.
Yep.
Soon a web of, okay, webs of distrust, lies, and mysterious entanglements, probably on every one of these movies.
Jada?
Result in danger and a near death when one of them crosses the lines to get the child, the husband, and suburban life she always coveted. Stolen in her sleep is another one.
These are very darker.
They're darker.
Yeah.
A Working Mom's Nightmare.
Hmm.
Too Young to Be a Dad.
Now that's interesting.
Let's look at Too Young to Be a
Dad. Is it like through a series of unfortunate circumstances, a 12-year-old boy has to adopt his baby sister?
Dude, there is a huge star in this movie.
Who?
So this must be older. This must be older. Paul Dano's in this.
Oh, shit. Our Riddler from the newest Batman.
There's probably a little more street cred on Lifetime. Like, people are probably, like, you're not going to see future stars doing Hallmark, but maybe you'll see some doing Lifetime.
Here it is. I got it.
Yeah.
Future stars do Lifetime.
Yeah.
Washed up stars do Hallmark.
That's it.
If you remember Candace Cameron Bure, she was DJ on Full House.
Wow.
She's in a ton of Hallmark movies.
Uh-huh.
Ton. Sorry uh-huh. I don't want to say washed up. She's probably not washed up, but you know.
She's someone.
She's yeah. She's doing Hallmark. Well, you know,
she's just not washed up maybe because she's washed up herself, but you just once you get blacklisted, I mean, you're just kind of
yeah.
People don't want you.
Yeah.
You're not going to get it.
Yeah.
You'll get that though. You'll get Hallmark.
You can get Hallmark. A lot of people get Hallmark.
So Paul Dano, that's interesting. I'm going to go with just, there's one called Nanny Cam, and then there's one called Nanny Nightmare. So that's what leads me to believe that
a lot of nanny stuff. A
huge, huge part of this.
Yeah, I could see one of them's probably like a nanny, she had a kid.
Yeah.
Or a miscarriage.
Yeah.
Either way, she lost a child.
Somehow, some way.
And then she works for this family, becomes overly obsessed with their kid.
Right.
To the point where she starts to slowly morph into the mother figure. She starts to dress like the mother, talk and act like the mother.
Yeah.
Right. Tries to seduce the dad, mm-hmm. and who's like weed the mother out in a way. She could like slip a little something in the food over time to get rid of the mother. Mm-hmm. The mother starts to catch on to it. The dad's like, you're crazy, honey. You're just, you know, over your loss of sleep because you're working so hard.
Always.
And then that's it. Mm-hmm. A nanny for Christmas.
I'm going to make an argument here. I'm going to make a take.
Yeah.
These types of movies are the most catered to normal people.
Mm-hmm.
These types of movies are for a larger majority of the population.
Yeah.
Than any other type of movie that exists.
Mm-hmm.
I just think about what that Hallmark, and more just, I guess, the Lifetime right now. It's like, okay, what makes a good horror film? It's something that preys on your own fears, your own insecurities.
And yeah.
It's like most people in the world are just normal people who end up having to hire a nanny,
mm-hmm.
or they're like PTA moms.
Yeah.
You know, and what's your biggest fear? It's like, what's your biggest fear is that the person that you hire to watch your kid is a fucking psycho,
yeah.
who ends up trying to kill you,
yep.
or them. And then even on the flip side, it's like, what's most, you know, most people's biggest fears are like are losing a child and going insane.
Mm-hmm.
And so like these movies cater to the average person much more than anything else, than the artistic A24 film or the exciting Marvel film.
Yeah, for sure. You know? Yeah. Nobody can relate to multiverse leaping.
No,
but we can relate to small town snow globe shop.
Right.
You know, a movie that actually does very well what Hallmark fails to do in every single movie is You've Got Mail.
Oh.
Which is inspired on or essentially a remake of the old movie, which I've never seen, called The Shop Around the Corner.
Interesting.
And it's the same thing. Meg Ryan owns a small town bookstore.
Yep.
Tom Hanks is a big time businessman coming to, you know, put his Barnes & Noble-esque huge warehouse bookstore.
Right.
And they somehow like get connected through email.
Huh.
And so they're talking to each other. And over email.
Email.
Yeah, right. Over email, they connect. And they're both in relationships. Mm-hmm. But they're kind of dwindling. They're kind of dulling.
Right.
But they have chemistry over email.
Okay.
And they talk to each other secretly on AOL Instant Messenger. But in person, they can't stand each other because right. she's like, well, here you are. You're going to kick me out. This is my everything.
Right.
Dave Chappelle is Tom Hanks' friend for some reason in that movie.
Is that real? But it works. Real?
It's great. Yeah.
Wow.
And so, yeah, it's one of those like, will they, won't they? They're great on email. When are they going to find out that they actually hate each other in real life? And, you know.
Absolutely.
So it does it very well. It's great.
Right.
Hallmark, not so much.
There does seem like there was a run there. You Got Mail is a great one.
Mm-hmm.
Is that Sleepless in Seattle?
Love Sleepless in Seattle.
You yep. know, it's like there was those types. They were just really high quality.
When versions. Harry Met Sally.
Yes.
They're all the same person. Nora Ephron, rest in peace.
Yeah.
I hate that she died because she was great at what she did.
Yes.
She can make you feel that warm, fuzzy. Just those three movies alone are some of my favorites.
It's that cinematography too. It's mm-hmm. that late 90s. Cinematography,
yeah,
very just city, you know,
New York. They're all like New York or Seattle movie, yeah,
right. Unfortunately, someone also who's really good at that, who's a sick fuck, Woody Allen.
Oh, I'm glad you mentioned that because I was just introduced to a movie called A Rainy Day in New York.
I mean, come on,
and I actually really liked it,
right?
Timothy, charcuterie board jawline.
He's in that.
He's in it.
Wow.
Selena Gomez is in it.
Wow.
Ellie Fanning.
Whoa.
There's some names. Liev Schreiber.
Yeah. Sabretooth.
And Jude Law.
Okay.
It's a cast.
Jude Law's around those.
Jude Law.
He's in that somewhere.
Yeah.
One of those types. Yeah. He'll hang out.
Mm-hmm.
He just hangs around. It's like, oh, you making one of those again?
Yeah.
All right, let me, come on.
Yeah.
You know you need me.
The Holiday? Sure.
Yeah, I'll be in that.
Cameron Diaz? All right.
So that's, well, so it's, okay, that's interesting because mm-hmm. you bring up a wonderful point that there are some incredibly high quality, big named mm-hmm. versions of Hallmark movies.
Yes, they're out there.
They're out there.
And they're rare, and I think that's why they're better, because Hallmark is churning them out. We talked about this, so there's just too much stuff.
It's just...
That's Hallmark. Hallmark's been in that game for a while, where they're like, let's just a movie every week, basically. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But you gotta respect... And you know what? It's one of those things where I ask you, as a creator, could you settle for that gig?
I couldn't.
Yeah, it'd be hard, wouldn't it?
I couldn't do it. Even the money, if there was money, which, like, I wonder, you know,
right.
How much does Hallmark shell out to a writer, director for a movie?
Right.
I don't know. I almost would want to take it on just to see if I could challenge myself with making the best Hallmark movie there ever was.
Right.
The one that changes the game. Where they're
game
like,
changer.
You know, they'll do a documentary down the line and they're like, he just, you know, he changed the game. Yeah. We talk about cliches. That's in every documentary.
Yeah. Yeah.
Fill in he the just, blank. Just change the game.
Change the game. You never saw a Hitchcock zoom in a Hallmark film until Estevan took on the project of Downtown Corner Store for Christmas. Yeah. He changed the game.
He changed the game. he was doing things no one else was thinking to do.
Never have you seen a dolly shot in a Hallmark movie. I mean, it was really just, you know, this guy was just, he was zigging while other people were zagging.
You know, all these other people, they were just putting the camera on a tripod and panning with the characters. Yeah. He was the first one to take the camera off the tripod. And follow them and tell the story with the lens. We had never seen anything like that.
You could do like, I would think you could do, I mean, you could take, I think they should dip their toe into the comic book genre, but make it like, you know how Batman had Batman and Catwoman? Just mm-hmm. make the whole movie that, but not Batman, but like just some sort of vigilante.
That would be cool.
And just make the whole movie that, though, like much, much less actual cool crime fighting. And
yeah.
Much more like Batman, Catwoman.
Yeah.
That would change the game.
That would change the game.
My interest right now, you know, and it would be a fun challenge. And it's like there's a part of me that wants to make some sort of now like absurdist, abstract version of one of those movies that really leans into it
mm-hmm.
in a self-aware way that doesn't even make fun of it. But just like I just want like, you know. A Hallmark movie exactly like it is,
mm-hmm.
but just with the occasional insanity of like, I don't know, like just throw in a guy cutting his own dick off in there or something.
Yeah, something crazy.
Something just, you know, that'll change the game.
The Hallmark cinematic universe.
Yeah.
Let's see the crossovers.
Well, wouldn't that be fun? Okay. I mean, because, okay, that in and of itself is a trope, is a modern trope right now.
Yeah.
That in and of itself is, and I think people might pick up on that. I think that might, I think Hallmark should do the Hallmark cinematic universe.
Can you imagine like Deadpool for Christmas?
Yeah.
Oh, Deadpool should totally rip on Hallmark.
Absolutely.
That's a Deadpool thing to do. But like a Hallmark movie where they break the fourth wall.
Yes.
I doubt they've got that.
They're just like, look at this. They look at the camera and they're just like, we know who you are.
Yeah.
We know that you're at home you're stressed out, you're tired, and you hate your life.
You just put the kids down for a nap. You
put the kids down for a nap.
You made yourself a turkey club.
And a Xanax martini.
Yeah. And you're just looking to escape. Welcome to Hallmark.
Welcome to Hallmark.
Yeah.
That should be there. You're just looking to escape.
Yeah.
Hallmark, you're just looking to escape.
Hallmark should have a theme park.
Yeah.
Why not? They could have the snow globe carousel.
Mm-hmm.
Where that would actually be kind of fucking cool. Like you walk into a giant snow globe.
Yeah.
And you're riding on the little horsies, but it's like blowing just snow constantly everywhere. It's like you're in a blizzard.
And there's, it'd be like Hollister, just like dudes with their shirts off, six packed out.
Yes.
You know.
And it doesn't matter what time of year you go there, it's fucking freezing.
Yep.
Absolutely. Where you have to wear those New York jackets.
And there's a wedding.
Mm-hmm.
There's the wedding ride.
The wedding ride. Yeah. Where you ride on like the bride's train.
Yeah.
A little coaster.
You get to be the bride for the day.
Yeah.
You get to be the bride.
There's the the hay, what do they call that? Like the hay truck. Hayride. That's it.
They get one of those.
Yeah.
The romantic hayride.
Yes.
You know.
They would have a kissing booth.
And for sure. Like a little extra, like one of those shirtless guys will finger blast you.
Yeah. Just for a little. You got to get like the Disney Genie Plus. Hallmark Plus pass.
You got to get the Hallmark Plus. Yeah. It's kind of like half Hallmark, half Chippendales.
Yeah, yeah.
Like private male stripper.
Yeah, exactly.
He'll do a little extra.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's like, perfect.
He'll rub his balls on your face.
Something like that.
For an extra pass.
Yeah. Yeah, you can simulate a scene.
Yeah.
Where like you don't say the thing that you should say that would solve everything.
Yes.
You get to live that live. Do you remember like that. They used to have those things where you would stand in front of a green screen and it would record you and it would put you in some of your favorite movies. Did you ever do one of those?
So I never did one of those, but when I was a baby, me and my dad did a green screen sports reporting.
There you go.
From the San Francisco 49ers locker room.
Oh, that's cool.
I'm going to cry. I'm not actually going to cry. But it's a cute thing.
Yeah.
It's sweet. I have the VHS somewhere.
Yeah. Of course. Yeah. VHS. That's where it all is. Yeah. But you could do that for Hallmark, dude.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Put yourself in a Hallmark movie.
Put yourself in a small town, green screen, small town bakery.
Yes.
Play it out. Do the, you know, get your scones.
Mm-hmm. Put yourself in the stables.
Yeah.
Yeah.
God, we fucking, come on.
We have so many ideas.
We need to make some money here. Yeah, what the hell's happening?
What the fuck? Why are we podcasting? We need to like go and fix Hallmark.
We can go fix Hallmark.
Yeah.
I would love to fix Hallmark.
Wouldn't that be cool?
I'd love to get in there and just be like, we're changing things up.
Yeah. Tear down their little 10-step poster formula and just say, nah,
mm-mm.
This is a different game, baby.
Yeah. And then for the documentary 10 years later, 10 years down the line.
I remember he walked in there. It was his first day ever. He walked in there and he just ripped the poster off the wall. And I thought, oh, he's going to change the game.
He grabbed an intern and he smacked him in the face.
Yeah.
And that's when we knew he's going to change the game.
I remember someone suggested the title For Christmas, and he straight up took that MacBook Pro and hit him in the neck, right in the throat with it. That dude was never seen ever again.
It's perfect. This is just,
damn.
This is more fun than I thought. Yeah. I feel like we're going to get sucked into wanting to do this for a living.
Actually. I know. I'm terrified of that. I don't want that, but.
What if that's how people get into this?
They just have a bad idea and then.
They're just like, it's like to them, they're like, it's a joke. It's ironic. They're like, yeah. Oh yeah. Fucking imagine. They're like, yeah, we just moved to LA. We want to be the next Scorsese's, but like, yeah, fucking Hallmark. I fucking don't, you know what? Just for a joke, let's write a Hallmark movie as a complete fucking joke.
Yeah.
And then they just get really into it. And then they're like, that was the most exhilarating creative experience of my life. Like,
oh my God. Yeah. It gets picked up and they're like, holy shit, my life's about to change. I can really do this.
I think that has to be part of it too. Not besides the joke, but it has to be that, like, you realize that it's the dopamine rush of getting a script picked up.
Yeah.
You probably get addicted to that.
And then you're stuck. Mm-hmm. You're stuck there because then nobody else is going to take you seriously as a writer director. Mm-hmm. And where else are you going to go if Hallmark's the only one who's pumping your nads?
And maybe Hallmark's like abusive kind of.
Yeah.
They're like, you're nothing without us.
Mm-hmm. We made you.
Oh, jinx.
Damn.
We're on the same page.
Yeah. We just synchronized.
We synchronized. I like to think Hallmark is a dirty, corrupt business.
Probably. They might be laundering scheme. Why not?
Money laundering. Actually, hold on.
Like, who can put out that many movies all the time consistently?
Where are they getting that money?
Yeah.
It's not because it's good production value.
They're not like shitty homemade student looking films. They're like, you know, they've got the quality.
Those are some sets.
They're all very standard. And they are some sets, like, to decorate the whole thing and do the snow blowing and the, you know, and I don't know. I mean,
like ginormous castle weddings and shit.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. Come on.
That's not.
I mean, even cheap. A small budget, you got a bunch of people working.
You got a whole crew.
Yeah.
That's even worse. Imagine being like a grip
for a Hallmark movie.
Imagine being Best Boy Electric for a fucking Hallmark movie.
Imagine PAing for one of these no-name Hallmark stars.
Imagine one of those stars clapping at you like they're Scarlett Johansson.
Yeah.
I'd punch a motherfucker in the face.
For real.
I'd be like, are you serious right now? We are both on the bottom of the barrel.
Yeah.
Don't fucking come at me like you're Leo.
Yeah. Oh, you're going to snap at me for a coffee, dude. I could read your lines the same way.
Like, we are the same.
We are the same.
We are
one. A PA and a star in a Hallmark movie are on the same tier.
Same exact
Absolutely.
Thing. Absolutely. Same exact thing.
Yeah. You know, actually, now that you mentioned Lifetime, I think You, the show that's so popular on Netflix, started on Lifetime.
Dude.
And then became something. So there's a good success story from Lifetime, at least.
That's a great example of what it's like the Sleepless in Seattle, but it's like that for Lifetime.
Yeah.
It's totally because it's smart, it's self-aware, it's nuanced. And then it's also super corny.
Yeah.
And it's very much just like this it preys on all the fears. What if the guy, the cute guy you met at the bookstore, that's a wonderful trope.
Yeah.
Cute guy you met at the bookstore wanted to kill you.
Secretly a sociopsychopath.
Yeah. Secretly was watching you. The whole reason he was at the bookstore is because he knew you'd be at the bookstore.
Yeah.
What if?
What if?
They need to make a dating app, one of these. Do they have that yet? They have to, right?
A dating app?
Tinder, like a Tinder, like murderer guy.
Mm.
Just that.
Just
Tinder
yeah.
murderer guy should be the name of the movie.
That's a flawless name.
Yeah. Just Tinder murderer guy.
For Christmas. No, you know, earlier you mentioned Paul Dano as a surprise. And I remember a long ass time ago, seeing a movie. It might have been Lifetime. Where Zac Efron plays this like autistic kid who runs. And I think that was like his first role, like before High School Musical.
Wow.
Like one of his first roles.
Yeah.
But also Mary Louise Parker is in it.
Okay.
And I don't remember the name of the movie, but
they'll do those.
Yeah.
So he did the old Gilbert Grape thing, didn't he?
Yeah. Yeah. A little bit.
He did the old Gilby Grape, didn't he?
Yeah.
I like this better than I played a dead body on CSI before I got super famous.
Yeah. Because
that seems to be the normal. That's like the usual. Oh, like, here's a clip of everyone on It's Always Sunny playing a random guy on CSI.
Yeah.
Fuck that. Fuck the CSI thing. Play an autistic kid.
Yeah.
In a Lifetime movie.
Mm-hmm.
And then make it big.
And then, yeah. And then do High School Musical.
And then do High School
Musical. Become like one of the hottest men to ever exist.
To ever grace the screen.
Yeah.
And I like that better for an origin story.
It's a cool origin story. Then
I did a couple of CSIs
mm-hmm.
while I was roommates with Michael Fassbender.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, everybody.
That's boring.
Yeah, that's boring. We've heard, we've seen that.
We know that one.
Zac Efron came in and he changed the game.
Yeah. He changed the game.
He did.
He ate Gilbert Grape.
Yeah. He answered the question, what is eating Gilbert Grape? It's Zac Efron from that movie Zac where Efron. He likes to run.
Move out of the way, Leonardo.
Leonardo.
Because Efron's here.
Yeah.
To do that better.
Mm-hmm. So, wow, we...
Yeah.
Well, this turned into just a Hallmark episode.
It did, and I'm glad.
I'm glad.
I'm grateful for that.
Because now we can continue our cliche stuff on another episode.
This has to be, this has to be something this has to be one of our things mm-hmm. now.
Yeah.
This feels very... You know, when you're sitting down, when we're sitting down and we're saying we want to make a podcast and we want to call it Redband and we kind of want it to be movies, pop culture, music, film, and but we also want to be a little bit anti that and we want to do hot takes and we want to make it funny and we want to be like, you know, a little bit like absurdist in our approach. Conspiracies and yada yada. But you never like things have to become things. As you go and yeah. you never are sitting there and going like, we need to carve out a corner in the Hallmark Lifetime commentary.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then that happened to us today.
It did
naturally.
I think
organically,
we have been blessed many times by the content gods.
Yes.
And I think they touched our souls again today and said, here's a little nugget for
here's
you.
Here's a little nugget.
Yeah.
That one's what happens when you show up and you just do it. You just sit down and you start going.
Yeah.
That can happen.
That can happen.
That's the magic.
So hopefully that inspires you to sit down and start going because you might get yourself a little Hallmark segment-esque thing to produce some content with.
But don't take ours because we will sue the shit out of you.
Yeah.
If you take this idea for yourself, you will be hearing from my lawyer.
Yeah.
Who will be have had just met a woman who owns a bakery shop.
Yeah.
In a small town.
And it will be a subpoena for Christmas.
Yeah. Damn fucking straight it will be a subpoena for it'll either be a subpoena for Christmas or it'll be I'm gonna make it look like a suicide for Christmas.
Oh. Ooh.
So don't yeah.
Yeah.
Don't take my ideas. I'll keep make your hands it look yourself. Like you did it to yourself for Christmas.
Lego my ego, baby.
Oh no.
Well, that was actually fun. I had fun doing that. So
that was amazing. That was better than talking about Doctor Strange.
Yeah. I mean, it honestly
was. It was.
Like it was more fun.
It was more fun than talking about Doctor Strange.
Yeah.
I think that's we found something today.
Well, yeah. I thank you for taking that journey with us.
Yeah, that was a journey.
We hope you go on your own and look at some Hallmark movies because it really is pretty unbelievable.
Yeah, just take a look.
Just take a look. We're not making this up. And stay tuned for our video series.
Yeah. Oh.
We're going to do something.
We're going to do something. And then I think we ought to watch some of these at some point.
Oh, yeah. I think so. We've been talking about watching some stuff that's pretty bad. On purpose for you all and like, you know, showing you our reactions to it. So we got to do that.
I think we found.
Yeah.
Where we'll be picking from.
Mm-hmm.
Couple of places.
Oh, that's the place to pick. It's ripe for the picking. But in the meantime, thank you for joining us. Thank you for listening.
Yes.
Tune in next week for... Who knows what for, really?
Who knows? We'll find
out. Yeah, we'll find out when you find out. Yeah. Or you'll find out when we find out. And please, please go subscribe to our YouTube channel. So you can you'll be notified when we drop this stuff. And follow us on all the platforms and leave us reviews because you can do that on these things now. Let us know how we're doing.
And God bless.
And God bless for Christmas.